Simon & Schuster Audio presents Please Join Us, a novel by Catherine McKenzie. Read by Joy Osmanski.
For the women in my pride, you know who you are. The door to Athena's apartment is open. I'm both relieved and petrified by this. Relieved because I'd been worrying on the frantic ride over about how I was going to get in without involving third parties, her doorman, the police, and petrified because it means that Athena's SOS message was real, that something actually is wrong, and she isn't simply being dramatic. I stand in front of the open door with my heart beating like a bass drum. Athena's is one of two apartments on this floor. The other door is firmly shut. I can't yell. That might result in more third-party involvement, although I'm already on the security footage in the elevator and the lobby. I'd glanced up at the camera downstairs and then away. The doorman knows me. I catalog all of this and conclude the obvious. There's no covering over the fact that I've been here, no matter what I find inside. The seconds are ticking away in time to my heart, and Athena needs help. But still, I linger. I don't want to know what's through this open door. I don't want my life to change in the way I know it will if I cross the threshold. If Athena requires an ambulance, she would have called 911. So it's bad, what I'm going to find. But final. My phone buzzes. I'd put on dark yoga pants and a hoodie when I got Athena's message, dressing for a crime I didn't know I was about to commit. My phone is in the pouch across my belly, its soft purr a tickle. I don't have to read it to guess who it is, nudging me through the door. Karma. I've been thinking about that word a lot lately. My phone buzzes again, and I enter, closing the door behind me gently. Even though there's no denying I've been here, I slip on the pair of surgical gloves I'd grabbed on the way out, moving quietly so I didn't wake my husband, Dan. I did anyway, and I murmured something about work, the lie slipping easily through my teeth. He turned over and went back to sleep, sadly used to the vagaries of my job. My heart's been getting a workout tonight. Athena's apartment is shrouded in soft light from a table lamp in the living room. I've always loved her home, the product of two classic sixes being knocked together to form something that feels both traditional New York and entirely original, a house inside a building complete with a full rooftop garden. The downstairs is made up of a large living room, dining room, and a massive kitchen/great room that's bathed in sunlight during the day and stares at Central Park. I walk quickly through the rooms, careful not to touch anything despite the gloves, hoping I'll find Athena downstairs, but with each empty room it grows more unlikely. I search for anything out of place, my mind logging as I go. There's a man's coat laid over the end of the couch, folded neatly. There are two wine glasses on the counter in the kitchen, stained a deep red. The sliding glass doors to the balcony are locked tight. I walk back to the staircase that leads upstairs, a modern combination of metal, glass, and wood, doing my best to keep quiet. I want to call out, to shout her name, to do one of those frantic, loud searches like you see on film, but I don't. I've been instructed to tell no one what I'm doing. Noise is the enemy. Silence and deliberation are required. It takes effort, though. I don't want to move toward whatever's waiting for me up these grand stairs. I want to bolt in the opposite direction, out into the night and the city, and then... I steady myself against the wall, my hands sweating inside the gloves. There's a painting at the top of the stairs that I love, a body of water, maybe a pool, that perfect blue of the sea in Antigua. The lines are blurred, so it's hard to tell, but it's beautiful. Blurred lines. That should be our anthem. I reach the top of the stairs. Up until now, the whole house has been as still as a tomb, only the gentle hush of the central air letting me know that the apartment's alive, even if no one else is. But now my ears are picking something up. A plinking sound. Water dripping. It's landing muffled. The bathroom. There are two of them, but instinct drives me to the guest bath to the left of me, the one right outside Athena's bedroom. I used it not that long ago, when we had a late night and I ended up sleeping over, calling Dan with my excuses, my lies, like I did tonight. Work, work. I always blame work. It's the reason I've done all of this, the origin of this moment. Whatever this is. I only need to push open the bathroom door to find out. My heart is thrumming again. I get another text. Again, I don't need to read it. Open the door, it will command. And for the first time, I wonder, am I on camera? I push that thought aside. The possibility of cameras leads to a cascade of thoughts that I don't have time for right now. I open it. My eyes flit over the room, the collection of data my brain's focus. Athena, naked, hunched in the corner of the generous bathtub. The water slowly dripping from the rainhead shower. The diluted streak of blood still circling the drain. Athena, I say, my voice steadier than it has a right to be. Are you all right? Her dark brown eyes are blank, her beautiful, famous face unmarred. She follows my gaze to the other end of the tub, watching the water drip into the basin, each drop thinning out the red to pink. It's not mine, she says in a hoarse whisper. It's Jack's. Part 1. Chapter 1. It's not us, it's you. Then, June. I blame the points committee. For those of you who don't live under the tyranny of yearly evaluations of your productivity and ability to bring in clients being plugged into a mysterious formula that spits out the number of points, i.e. money, that you'll receive each year, perhaps it seems silly to care. But when you've worked 60-hour weeks since you were 26, scratch that, your whole adult life, and you've made it, but you still haven't made it far enough, it's humiliating. Being a partner isn't good enough. Being in every best-of lawyer publication doesn't cut it. Putting yourself out there in a million ways that make you uncomfortable doesn't mean shit. If you didn't bring in the clients and or the billable hours, your points are cut. Doesn't matter that you helped build the place. Those years of 2,000-plus billable hours and no time to yourself, well, thanks, I guess, but what does that have to do with today? Nothing. Your points are being cut. You're taking a step down. You're now in the loser tier. And if you don't course correct, you're going to reverse lap the new partners in the most pathetic race ever. Not that they said that exactly, but the sad turn of my mentor Thomas's mouth when he walked into my office and shut the door to deliver the news said it all. Without some radical intervention, my days were numbered. When Thomas left without giving me any advice on what to do other than to say we'd just have to wait and see if my profile turned into files, I sat at my desk and stared at my computer screen as if it might deliver answers. What had gone wrong? Sure, the last year had been less busy, but that was because one of my main clients had gone bankrupt. It wasn't my fault. I wasn't their financial advisor. They were the kind of client you didn't replace in 10 seconds or in 10 months. But that hadn't been taken into account. I'd done everything I was asked to and more, and it hadn't been enough. What was I supposed to do now? I needed to get out of my head, so I called Dan. Should I be putting pink champagne on ice? he asked as a greeting, the answer assumed, his anticipation of our celebration palpable. I felt the sudden need to cry. Dan had sung those words, like he often did, with the confidence of certainty. In 39 years, Nicole Mueller had never failed, so I had to be calling with good news. I turned my back to the glass door of my office so no one could see when the tears fell. No, decidedly not.
Wait, what?
I could imagine Dan sitting in his own office in Jersey City. He was in-house counsel at a bank, changing paths 5 years ago when he didn't make partner. I'd supported his choice. We didn't both need to be working this hard, particularly if his firm wasn't going to recognize his worth. The bank paid well and let Dan have his weekends. It was an easy decision. They put me in the Samuel tier, I said, naming a partner who was 1 point away from being kicked out.
The loser tier? No, you're shitting me.
I wish I was. I stared hard at my computer screen, blinking back tears. It was open to Facebook, a place I went when I needed to distract myself for a minute or 10 with pictures of cute puppies and smart-alecky kids.
Why?
My hours were down.
But Alcorp went bankrupt.
I know.
That wasn't your fault.
I said that.
They didn't give you any warning?
I thought back to the meeting I'd had with the points committee in May. Everything was positive. In January, I'd been named as one of the top 40 lawyers under 40 and had been featured in a prominent lawyer's magazine. I'd made a bunch of other lists, too. The clients loved me, my hours were down, but they were sure that was a blip. I was a model for others to follow, they'd implied, maybe even said, as Thomas nodded along like a proud parent. I'd left the meeting confident. Getting their decision today felt like being in front of a judge who's made up her mind but doesn't tell you what she's going to do, so you have no way of convincing her otherwise. No, there was no warning. Thomas seemed so guilty. Dan growled.
Fuck Thomas.
Yeah.
Seriously, Nick, you should leave.
I stared at my hands. My nails were chipped and ragged. Was I not polished enough? Was that why? I've never been big on personal grooming. Oh, that sounds bad. I'm a clean person. I dress well, and my shoulder-length chestnut hair is well-kept, but the extra primping that a lot of professional women seem to find the time to do, I've never had the patience for it. And go where?
Lots of firms would be happy to take you.
I turned away from Facebook, facing my windowsill. It was cluttered with the plaques they encouraged you to buy when you made all those lists. Best lawyers, chambers, who's who. I was in all of them. Future star, litigation star, consistently recommended. I was supposed to make full equity partner this year. That was the plan. Instead, I was moving away from that goal. Not now. I should have taken Foster's up on their offer last year.
What's changed?
Me, in the eyes of the legal world.
You don't have to tell them about the points.
I smiled sadly at my own reflection. My dark blue eyes were tired, and my hair was pulled back too tightly from my face, making me seem severe. I looked like a loser, despite Dan's optimism. It was one of the things I loved most about him, how naive he still was, his Ohio earnestness firmly in place despite more than 15 years in this city. It was why he didn't make partner. His firm didn't think he had a killer's instinct, and they were right. They probably already know.
How?
Because people don't sit on this kind of information. My email pinged, dragging my eyes back to my screen.
God damn it!
What? I just got an email from Albert and Prince. The recruiters?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.